Hello and good morning. Welcome back to my channel. My name is Gavin. Thank you so much for being here. If you are new on this channel, we dig deep into unsolved crimes. We get our hands on documents. We get down into the nitty-gritty. We roll around in it. We get ourselves covered in it. And that's what we're going to do today. We're going to take a deeper dive into the murder of Sara Matthews Easton. If this is your first time looking at this case, this is part two. I've done two previous videos. One was an in-depth part one into kind of looking into the life of Sara Easton leading up to the day that she was murdered, which happened on August 16th, 2015. And then I did another video that was kind of a question and answer. I call it my Sunday drive video. So if this is the first time you're looking at Sara Easton's case, I suggest you go back to part one, and I will leave a link to that in the description below. Just head on over there. And then when you come back, you can join the rest of us as we dig deep into the case of Sara Matthews Easton. Okay, so today there are a couple things that I want to do. I want to answer a couple more questions that have come in, and then I'm going to go through crime scene photos, and then I'm going to dive into some of the documents, including some of the police report, including their narratives. They have these supplemental reports they call narratives, and the autopsy and toxicology report. I want to give a little background on how I got my hands on the crime scene photos. By the way, if you go over to my website, gavinfish.com, you can go click on cases right up here and then click on Sara's photo, and you will come to this case page, which has the videos that I've done on it. By the time you see this, there will be a third video. Photos of Sara and Aaron and their family, some crime scene photos, and the case documents, including a couple of others that are connected, though not directly to Sara's death. They're more connected to Aaron Easton and kind of his shenanigans leading up to and even after Sara's death. I want to give this background on the crime scene photos, though, just so you guys know that these actually aren't the official crime scene photos. This is what happened. When I first got in touch with my sister about this case, Rick, my partner Rick Tracewell on Solve Crimes with Rick and Gavin back in the day, learned about this case in Yuba City, and I felt like I knew this person. Like, it just seemed like I knew this person. I reached out to my little sister, and sure enough, it was a friend of my little sister. I won't go into the long details about that. I definitely did in part one. But my little sister put Rick and I in touch with Sara's family, one of whom is her brother, Johnny. Now, Johnny, if I can characterize this, I want to be fair about this, but I think the words that Johnny used when he told us about his relationship with his sister was that they kind of had a special bond in that they were both kind of black sheep in the family. They had gone against their parents' wishes in a few ways, or in Sara's case, in a lot of ways, and they kind of bonded over that. And so Johnny was very open, very willing to talk to us, really wanted somebody to look closely at Sara's case. Now, it turns out that Johnny had worked for a company that specialized in cleaning up crime scenes, or at least that was one of their services. And he knew the people who had done the crime scene cleanup, or I guess officially it would have been the death scene cleanup. And he said he had never looked at the photos before, he had never asked for the photos before, but he gave us permission to contact them and ask them for the photos. And if I recall correctly, there was nothing illegal about them showing us or sharing us those photos, but they required that we get permission from at least one of Sarah's next of kin, which we did, and we got our hands on the photos. So these photos that I'm going to show you today and the ones that are over on the website down here, let me get you over here. These photos came from the crime scene cleanup crew. They're not official photos from, say, the California Department DOJ or the Yuba City Police or the Sutter County Sheriff's Department. I just want to be very clear about that. I think this is as close as we're going to get to crime scene photos while the case remains open, which it currently is at the California Department of Justice. And we'll get into that a little bit. So before we totally dive in, I do want to address a couple of questions that have come in. I know I did some questions that came in on my last video, but there are a couple more that came in that I thought were terrific. Number one, Lee Jacobs 2649 said, I wonder if it's possible for a shooter with GSR on them could stage, I think they're just, to if they could stage the scene by rubbing their hands, arms, clothes onto the victim's hands in the hopes of transferring even a small amount that would test positive from a swab. Then the shooter cleans themselves up in the case they're tested. I think I read that correctly. And I understand what you're saying, Lee. I think that is a terrific question. And I did not know the answer to that question, so I had to go on a search and I looked it up. Turns out that GSR tests, there are two levels of GSR tests, very similar to the way they do it in toxicology. The first is what they call a qualitative test, and that qualitative test will give you either a positive or negative result, yes or no, if there was GSR. If there is GSR, they then can do a quantitative test. They can find out how big the particles are, how many of them are, and how many particles within the different size ranges there are. And this is important because it turns out that GSR can be transferred by something as simple as a handshake or a touch. You don't even really have to wipe anything. You can just touch and that GSR will be transferred. And in that case, the transfer would test positive in the qualitative test. But when they go on to the quantitative test, it turns out that mostly the ones that transfer are the larger particles. The smaller particles tend not to. And so forensic scientists can say with a certain degree of scientific certainty whether something was either a transfer or it was GSR from the gun itself, which is pretty amazing that they can do that. Thank you very much for that comment and that question. The next comment that came in came from, it's just me from Ohio. That person says, the only thing I needed to hear was two shots in the head. Nobody shoots themselves in the head twice. Now, this, I guess, rumor, this idea that Sara Easton was shot in the head twice is a rumor. It's something that Rick Source, who originally brought us this case, told him. It is something that prior to getting documents in the case, we believed because we had heard that from several people, even inside of government and law enforcement in the area. But it turns out that the documents show that Sara was not shot in the head twice. It turns out that there were two gunshots reported by Aaron Easton to responding officers, but there was only one bullet that had been fragmented that was inside of Sarah's head. Guys, it is so dry in the Northeast right now. I can't get enough water. Anyway, so it's just me from Ohio. Thank you very much. And I did respond to that comment and clarified that. But I wanted to share that with you guys because I believe that in the video that Rick did on this case a month or two after I left Solve Crimes, he did say that she had been shot in the head twice, though at that point there were no case documents that he would have had access to. So I kind of give him a pass on that. I think that's perfectly fine. Okay, so with that, I want to go over to the crime scene photos. I'm going to continue to call them crime scene photos, though you guys know these really are cleanup scene photos. You can go through them one by one on my website, gavinfish.com. I can't remember if I mentioned it or not, but all of these are available for everybody. The case documents, though, because oftentimes when I get case documents, they're very expensive to get, and it's my Patreon supporters that allow me to get my hands on them, to be able to afford them. Those are reserved just for my patrons. So if you would like to take a close look at the documents, I'm going to show them to you. I'm going to show several of them to you in this video. But if you want direct access to those documents, I invite you to join me on Patreon, and I'll put a link down below. Okay. So back to the scene photos. This is the evening after Sarah was killed. She was shot early in the morning. So this is not, these are not photos from that early morning scene. This is from the evening. You can see, I believe this is Aaron Easton's police cruiser right here. Just photos from the outside. This is the first photo that I wanted to show you guys. This is their bed and the nightstand. And then this is a wall. They have like this curio in front of it and a piece of a couch, it looks like. And this is where Sarah lay, this spot kind of right here, right there. That's where Sarah lay. That's where her head was. And then you can see that there are drag marks. In the police report, the Yuba City officer who responded said that he dragged her out into the middle of the room to get better access to her. And this yellow tarp right here is a tarp that the cleanup crew brought in to put all of the like blankets and sheets and bed covers and stuff like that onto. So that this wasn't placed there by police, though we can see a better picture of that here. Again, she has been dragged from this direction up in the top right. And this is the bed. I think they show us underneath. So this would have been where her head was when she was turned over and cleared her oral cavity. Now, I don't think that I need to go through every single one of these photos. You can do that on the website, but there are a couple that I think are important. This one I think is important. This patch of bed would have been, from my understanding, cut out by police. That wasn't done by the cleanup crew, to my knowledge. That would have been done by police. Remember, Aaron said that Sarah was laying on the bed and that he put her onto the floor in order to do CPR. That's what he said. And then I wanted to zoom up on this right here. I don't know what these are. This wall that we're looking at that their bed was up against is the outside wall of the house. To me, that looks like that could be, or those could be bullet holes. It also looks like it could be like remnants of a shelf, like drywall anchors or something like that could have been there. It's unclear to me what those holes are, but it looks like they're the only one. So if it were a shelf, then it would have been a solo shelf. I guess what I'm saying is I can't rule out that these holes came from something else, but I am suspicious that they might be bullet holes. This next photo that I want to show you is of the nightstand. I believe that some of this under here is blood splatter. I don't know, or blood splatter. I can't remember, but there's also some on the side of the bed here. I'm wondering if that could have happened when Sarah was brought down onto the floor. But the key thing for me is that I don't see anything on top of the nightstand. And the reason that's important to me is that we know that Sara was shot on the left side of her head. And if she were laying on her back, then I believe there would have been spatter out. You know what I mean? So you'd think that there might be blood on top of the nightstand, though who knows what was on the nightstand. And we know that there were sheets and stuff on the bed, so it's very, very difficult to tell. Here's another scene of that where you can see some of that spatter up onto the bed. But to me, I don't know, that looks like an impact point to me because of the spatter. Let me get you back over here. I didn't realize that. Yeah, so there is spatter right up here on the bed. And then that just looks like an impact point to me, as like it looks like spatter kind of goes out from there, I guess is what I'm saying. Here's a wider shot of the room. You can see those holes up on the wall up here. I think just so you guys can kind of tell, there is a walk-in like sliding glass door in their bedroom. There's a window. I actually have pictures from Zillow of the house, just so we can kind of understand the layout of the house. Front door kind of opens up into a main living area, and then the bedrooms are kind of off in the back. They're all next to one another. This is the master bathroom, picture of the garage. Where did I wanted to take you out here. So this is that screen or that sliding door. So their bedroom is in the back corner of this house, I guess is what I'm trying to say. The other bedrooms would be all on that side of the house as well. So on this side of their bedroom would be the children's bedroom, one of the children's bedrooms on the other side of this wall. And then there are a couple things that I noticed about the bathroom. Is kind of from where this picture is taken, it's kind of behind the camera. You can see it here. And there, like, it looks to me like those are probably Aaron's clothes that are placed on the floor right there. To me, that kind of looks like he had a shower. Now, I don't know if that would have been like before the police arrived, or if it would have been between the time the home was released to the cleanup, or, you know, was in the custody of the police, the investigators, and then released to the cleanup crew, or if it would have been something from beforehand. Maybe he showered before bedtime. I don't know, but those photos, I'm a little bit suspicious of the fact that it looks like there had been a shower there. I think that's, this is in between the bed again. This is the spot where Sara lay originally before she was dragged out, to where she could be worked on a little easier. They opened up that carpet. It did soak into the padding below. And then when you look at these, you can see that there are red spots in the concrete below once they removed all of that carpet. So while maybe this photo makes it look like there wasn't really all that much blood, it did soak through and stain the concrete beneath. There are a couple of spots on the concrete. They even took pictures of them that were stained by the amount of blood that made it in there. So I think that's kind of maybe all I wanted to share with you guys when it came to the crime scene. Now, you can look at these photos to your heart's content over on my website, gavinfish.com. You can check them all out, and I invite you to do that. So we kind of understand the scene. Now, what I want to do is shift focus over to a few of the documents in this case. I want to start out over here with Sara's death certificate. Now, I told you in the last video that while the Matthews family did get a copy of her death certificate, they never got an unredacted version of it. And the redaction covered her manner and cause of death. So they never knew until 2021 when my sister helped to get an unredacted version of this. My little sister, as I said in the last video, works in the funeral business. She kind of knows the ins and outs of California law, and she was able to get her hands on to this unredacted version of it. The kind of strange thing about this is that when we go, I'm going to go down here first. First off, it says that, how do I do that? There we go. It says that the manner of death is still pending investigation as of 2021, still pending investigation. And when we go up to the cause of death, it says gunshot wound of the head pending toxicology. So it appears to me that they never updated the death certificate, which I don't know why they would do that. It is a normal thing when toxicology comes in, when a medical examiner takes a look at the autopsy, looks at the circumstances of the death, they come up with a cause and manner of death. They update the death certificate. But in this case, they have not. Now, my question was, what does toxicology have to do with anything having to do with a gunshot wound to the head? I want you guys to keep that question in mind as we move forward here, because we're going to answer that question, I believe. But before we do that, I want to get into a couple of the reports from the Yuba City Police Department, okay? This is from an officer named Chris Cornwell, and I want to go through what he said happened the early morning hours where he responded to Sarah and Aaron's house. He says, I responded with my overhead emergency lights / sirens activated from the area of State Route 99, Sunsuite Avenue. Upon arrival, redacted, flagged me down. Now, I think this is important that redaction is small. I think the word underneath there is Aaron. And Aaron Easton is the chief of police in Marysville. So they would have done, there would have been plenty of interfacing between the Marysville police and the Yuba City police. So it shows me that when he came on scene, he knew whose house he was going to, and he called him by his first name. So he knew him. Okay. That, at least that's what I suspect. I don't think that in that black box we would see Mr. Easton, Chief Easton, Aaron Easton. I think that just says Aaron. Okay. So Aaron flagged me down in front of his residence. I think this says Aaron again. Was only wearing a pair of basketball shorts with no shirt, shoes, or socks on. That takes me back to the crime scene photos where we look at maybe the idea or the fact that there had been a shower taken, right? He was only wearing basketball shorts, no shirt, no socks, no shoes. He directed me inside, stating that Sarah, I'm guessing that said Easton, had shot herself in the head. So Aaron is already saying she shot herself in the head. He stated she was in the back of the bedroom of the residence. He went to the back bedroom and located Sarah lying supine on the floor of the north wall of the master bedroom. She was next to her bed in front of a nightstand. Oh, no. I'm sorry. He's not saying Aaron said that. He's saying he said that. I went to the back of the bedroom, located Sarah lying supine on the floor of the north wall of the master bedroom. She was next to her bed in front of a nightstand. Okay. I actually got I confused myself. I've read this probably 24 times, but I confused myself there. On top of the nightstand, I observed a Glock Model 26 semi-automatic pistol. So on this nightstand right here, there was that Glock 26, which we found out was his service weapon. The pistol was locked out of battery. I could see and smell gun smoke in the air. I noted that Sara was bleeding profusely from the left side of her forehead. I could see brain matter protruding through her skull. I noted Sara was still breathing, though it was extremely labored. Aaron and I believe that says Aaron, drug Sara out from in between the bed and the wall and into the middle of the room. I rolled Sara into a lateral recumbent position in an attempt to better open her airway. Her breathing was still labored, but she appeared to be breathing better than before. As she lay there, I watched as a large amount of blood cleared from her oral cavity. Paramedic Justin Johnson from Bi-County Ambulance arrived at this time and assumed care of Sara. Then there's a whole giant redaction. So we don't know what that says. As he was sitting on the couch, I'm assuming this is Aaron, Aaron heard two distinct gunshots. He described the succession of both as being fast. I think this is where the rumor came from about the two gunshots to the head. He heard two distinct gunshots, the succession of which were fast. Aaron went into the bedroom where he found Sara lying on her back on the bed. He said he removed, so she's lying on her back on the bed, according to what this officer said his statement was. So I don't know, since there was no exit wound on the right side, which I don't know if you guys can see where I'm pointing here, this right side, I would expect there to be spatter out here on the left side, and maybe there was on the bed, but they didn't make it over to the nightstand, I guess. Okay, let's see. He moved her from the bed to the floor and called 911 for help. He continued doing CPR. Bunch of redactions. At this time, I transported Aaron to Rideout Hospital and sat with him in the waiting room. The emergency department staff worked on Sara until life was no longer sustainable. Dr. Orchard pronounced death at 0514 hours. So at that point, Officer Cornwall, I guess, you know, forwarded his report on to the detectives. Now, here's something that's interesting. Mobile audio video, that's the body cam. MAV Media number 114506, a personal body camera, was also worn during this incident. At the time of this report, the body camera was not able to be downloaded. It was preserved, and the IT department was contacted to retrieve the video footage. So apparently there's something wrong with the body camera. So that is from Officer Cornwell. The next one that I want to take a look at is a supplemental report by an Officer Baker. Again, this is the Yuba City Police Department. And this talks about the search warrant a little bit, and that's why I wanted to read it, okay? It says, on the morning of 8/16/15, I received a telephone call from Sergeant Runyon regarding this case. I responded to the scene. Redaction, at approximately 04:39 hours, I met with Sergeant Runyon and he walked me through the scene and gave me a brief overview of what had transpired. Detective Morozinski, I'm butchering that name, I'm sorry. And I then went to Rideout Hospital and arrived there at approximately 05:30. Huge redaction. At approximately 06:30, I spoke to blank in room F at Rideout Hospital. I explained to me that looks like Aaron Easton right there, like he didn't know him. And then this looks like Aaron. So I explained to Aaron that we were going to secure a search warrant for his residence so we could complete our investigation. At first, Aaron was set back by this, but then understood it was the best way for the scene to be handled. While talking to Aaron, Deputy Middleton from the Sutter County Sheriff's Department arrived and wanted to talk to Aaron regarding the coroner's investigation. In Sutter County, the sheriff is the coroner. I was in and out of the room while Aaron was talking to Deputy Middleton. Big redaction. After Aaron was done speaking with Deputy Middleton, I gave him a ride back to his residence, 0746. Aaron then voluntarily gave me his cellular phone so it could be examined at a later time. I later gave the cellular phone to Detective Slade. After Detective Slade secured a search warrant for the premises at, and then that's the address, it was determined that a request was going to be made to DOJ to process the residence. During the afternoon of 8/16/15, I was present when Detective Morozinski interviewed both blank, I have no idea, C. Morozinski's supplemental reports for details, and I do not have my report on that. I think the main thing is that when Aaron Easton was told that they were going to secure a search warrant, he did not like that. And then by 0746, he went back to his house. So it was like he had access to the house at 0746, which I think is kind of weird. Okay, the next thing is a report. This is a supplemental report from Officer David Krause. He says, on the 16th at approximately 0346, Officer Cornwell and I were dispatched to, and that would be the address regarding a suicide. So from the very beginning, I don't have the 911 call or the transcript, but Aaron would have said, my wife killed herself, right? Because they went there expecting a suicide. Officer Cornwell arrived before I did. He located the victim in the master bedroom. See Officer Cornwell's report, which we have seen. Sergeant Runyon arrived at the scene before I did. We have not seen his report. I arrived, entered the residence. I saw a gurney in the hallway of the residence, and I saw a male subject standing near it. The male, blank, I'm guessing that's Aaron Easton, appeared very upset. I looked into the master bedroom and saw a female on the floor being treated by paramedics. The female had an obvious head wound. She was unconscious and breathing. Paramedics and firefighters loaded the female onto the gurney and moved her to the ambulance. I asked Aaron for the female's name and date of birth. Aaron was talking to Officer Cornwell, and I had heard him state that he had been in another room when he heard two shots from the bedroom. Aaron ran into the bedroom, saw Sarah with a gunshot wound to her head. I'm inferring those, of course, they're redacted. Okay. I remained in the bedroom and took photographs of the scene. I saw a large amount of blood on a pillow on the bed and noticed a shell casing on bed next to the pillow. I also saw one unfired round on the bed near a pillow on the side of the bed opposite of the pillow with the blood. So, well, let's keep reading. I saw a firearm, a Glock Model 26, on the nightstand near the pillow that had the blood. The firearm had the slide locked open. The gun was located, or was loaded with a loaded magazine. So the magazine was still in the gun, but the slide was in a locked back position. Sergeant Runyon requested that I respond to blank and attempt to contact the victim's parents. Sarah's parents lived like just a couple minutes away from Sarah and Aaron. I responded to that address, and after knocking for some time, I got an answer at the door. I verified that the people I was talking to were the victim's parents, and I advised them of what happened. I asked that they respond to Rideout Hospital. I returned to, and that would be Sarah and Aaron's house. I stood with a bunch of people and two TIP volunteers. We all sat in the living room of the residence, and I watched the scene until I was relieved by Officer Willing. I placed the photos I had taken into evidence at the Yuba City Police Department, and he said no MAV recording. My MAV was not functioning in my patrol unit. So two officers with malfunctioning body cams or mobile audio video cams, which I find a little goofy, suspicious, I guess. It's just kind of weird. Okay, supplemental from Baker. This is 2 days later. Let's get you guys on here. Okay, let me get a drink of water here real quick. It is so dry out here, guys. On 8/18/15, the autopsy was performed on Sara Easton at Ulrich Chapel. At approximately 10:30 hours, I met with Dr. Arthur Kenny and I gave her an overview of the case, inclusive of showing her photographs from the scene at, I think it's 1159 Mariposa Drive. At approximately 1130 hours, Dr. Arthur Kenny began the autopsy. Present for the autopsy were myself, Sergeant Mercer from the Sheriff's Office, Detective Brow from the Sheriff's Office, Criminalist A. Brewer from the Department of Justice, Criminalist K. Wallace from the Department of Justice, and FMG Assistant J. Foster. During the autopsy, I assisted by taking numerous photographs when requested to do so by Dr. Arthur Kenny. There was one wound consistent with a gunshot on the left portion of Sarah's head. Dr. Arthur Kenny told me the bullet traveled from left to right, down to up, front to back. So here we go. Left to right, down to up, front to back. So kind of like this, right? I'm trying to give you guys a good, kind of like that. Yes. Okay. The bullet did not exit Sarah's skull. Dr. Arthur Kenny's final report will contain diagrams and measurements. The autopsy concluded at approximately 1600 hours. So they went from 1130 a.m. until 1600. To me, guys, that is a thorough autopsy. What is that? That's 4.5 hours. That is a long autopsy. From all the autopsy reports I've read, that is a long one. Dr. Arthur Kenny told me it was not a contact wound. So the gun was not up against her head, but some distance away. Okay. However, there was stippling present, but soot was not present around or in the wound. And I talked about this in my last video. The photographs were later transferred to a DVD, and I later placed the DVD into evidence. Of course, I do not have those photographs. On 8/20/15, 2 days after the autopsy, at approximately 14:45, so 2:45 in the afternoon, Detective Slade and I went to Lakeside Colonial Chapel and met with Joe Betancourt. Betancourt facilitated us in getting Sarah's arm measurements. So, left shoulder to elbow, 13 inches. Left elbow to left wrist, 11 inches. Left wrist to left middle finger, 6 inches. Right shoulder to right elbow, 13 inches. Right elbow to right wrist, 11.5 inches. Right wrist to right middle finger, 6.5 inches. So what is it that they were suspicious of? Maybe they were trying to put together. Could Sarah have done that? In fact, I'm trying to figure out a way that you could do that, you know, and keep the gun away from your head. I think they were trying to figure out the same thing by taking her measurements. And I am glad that they did, because it's my understanding that Sarah was cremated. So I think Aaron was trying to get rid of any possible opportunity for second autopsies or other measurements. But I'm glad they did this. So on 8:20 at approximately 16:10, so an hour and a half later, I spoke with RN Amber Cortez on the telephone. RN Cortez assisted in treating Sarah when she was brought into the hospital on 8:16. RN Cortez told me there were dressings applied to the wound on Sarah's head to control bleeding. However, there was no excessive cleaning or scrubbing of the wound to her head. Aaron Cortez stated there were no cleansers applied to the wound either. And I think this goes to the idea, okay, well, if there's no soot, then did they wipe that away, right? They were trying to rule that in or out. And I think that has the soot not being there and not having had any cleansers used to wipe it away, just having dressings applied to the wound, I think they're ruling out that soot may have been wiped away. Okay, and then this is just a property receipt. Okay, so we're getting closer and closer. All right, this again is from Officer Baker from the Yuba City Police Department, and he went on to say on the 19th of August, so 3 days after Sarah's death, A neighborhood canvas was conducted in the neighborhood surrounding the Easton residence. At approximately 1801, I spoke to Blank at her residence. She told me nobody was at the residence the previous Saturday night into Sunday morning. So that neighbor wasn't there. I then spoke to Blank at their respective residences. So two people, looks like, and two different residences. Neither of those parties contacted heard anything out of the ordinary the previous Saturday night into Sunday morning. I attempted to make contact at Blank and was unable to speak to anybody at that residence. So this shows me that they're looking around. Did anybody hear anything? Could we verify that two shots were fired, or were there more, or were there less, right? They're trying to figure that out. And that takes me back, guys, to like this picture, right? If these are bullet holes, which I'm suspicious of, like let's zoom in on this so that you can see it maybe a little better. That one right there and those two right there, like they're not in a line. Like if these were holes from like drywall anchors for a shelf or something like that, you'd expect them to be in line, but there's no pattern here, right? If you follow this line, like there's just no pattern, I guess is what I'm getting at, right? So maybe police are like, well, wait a minute, we've got one hole to the head, we've got three holes to this outside wall, that's four. So were there two shots? Were there, you know, it's as if, it makes me wonder if Aaron had like put pillows up against the wall to maybe like cover the, I don't know that this happened. I am completely in speculationville, but it's like, let's cover up these walls so that nobody sees these bullet holes here and then tell people this is a suicide. They'll believe me. I'm chief of police, right? But yeah, those to me look like bullet holes. That is four shots. Now, if they are bullet holes, that doesn't necessarily mean they were shot that night, right? It could have been some other night, but we can see that the Yuba City Police Department assisting the DOJ is trying to get to the bottom of this. I think they are suspicious. They're like, Sarah, I don't think this is a suicide the way that Aaron Easton claimed from the very beginning. Okay, let's go from this report over to the autopsy report and see what is going on over here. There are just a couple of things that are, I think, are important to me, because an autopsy report is a lot of measurements and so forth, which I don't think that I'm going to get into. But there is one part that bothers me about this autopsy report, and that is on the first page, the cause of death, gunshot wound to the head. Parenthetical minutes, whatever that means. I honestly don't know what that means. I feel like she died within minutes of, or she was effectively dead within minutes of getting a gunshot wound to the head. But then I saw this. Alprazolam and Zolpidem detected. I had to look that up because I didn't know exactly what those were, but I thought it was Xanax and Ambien, and indeed it was Xanax and Ambien. So if she had Ambien in her blood, which she did, when we go over to this toxicology report, this is the qualitative test, by the way, guys, this very beginning thing, this is the qualitative portion of it. They're basically going, is there or is there not these things, right? So Sarah tested zero for blood alcohol, no amphetamines, no antidepressants, no barbiturates, yes to benzodiazepines, and then no sedatives, no narcotic analgesics, no local anesthetics, no, you know, I guess other miscellaneous stuff. But she is positive for benzodiazepine. So then we go over to the quantitative test, and in that analysis, they found Zolpidem 0.03 milligrams per liter. Now, Zolpidem is Ambien. Okay? Now, what does that mean? So 0.3 milligrams per liter. I did a search, just a simple Google search, to see if I could find any studies that would tell me a little bit about the process of digesting or metabolizing Ambien. Ambien comes in two different sizes. I think one's a 6 milligram dose, one's a 10 milligram dose or something like that. And from what I read, Ambien stays in the blood from between 8 and 24 hours after it's taken. So I was just trying to think of what would have happened. We know that Sarah and Aaron and their kids went out to dinner that night. They came home, and so sometime probably after the kids went to bed and the time that police were called, Sarah would have taken an Ambien to go to sleep, right? Ambien is prescribed as, it's addictive. From what I understand, you're not supposed to take it for very long periods of time, but it was prescribed in order to get her to sleep. It's prescribed to people who are suffering from, what do you call that when you can't sleep at night? I almost said amnesia. You guys know what I'm talking about. She couldn't sleep, right? So she had 0.3 milligrams in her blood. From what I could tell just from my cursory search, that is about the amount that would be in the body of a woman, Sarah's, weight, within a few hours of taking the drug. And so then I started asking, well, is it possible to take an Ambien and not fall asleep? And the answer to that question is kind of no. I mean, I think you could build up a tolerance over time, but these prescriptions to Ambien are typically short term because of the high likelihood of addiction. And so I don't think that Sarah was accustomed to it. She hadn't built up a tolerance to it. I think it's reasonable to assume that she had taken the Ambien and she had fallen asleep. So with that, I mean, that takes me back to the manner of death being gunshot wound to the head pending toxicology. They would have been waiting for toxicology to confirm to see if there was anything in there. And of course there was Ambien, right? Xanax is used as an antidepressant, and Sarah was dealing with some, or at least her actions leading up to the time of her death are indicative of somebody who is dealing with depression. But Ambien was to help her to sleep. And so I personally believe that Sarah was likely asleep when she was shot. That's what I think. I would love to know what you guys think. And so please leave your thoughts in the comments below. And the next time we see each other, which will be on Sunday, we will, I'll go over some of your questions or your comments if you leave them in there when I go on my Sunday drive, which I think will be New Year's Eve, right? I can't remember. But anyway, I'll see you on Sunday. Hopefully I'll have some comments and questions from you guys. In the meantime, remember, you can go over to my website and you can see all of this stuff, everything that we've gone over, the scene photos, the case documents. And then if you're really interested, I think maybe you guys should take a look at this affidavit of probable cause against Aaron Easton the following year. Take a look at this lawsuit between a woman who was an assistant district attorney and Sutter County. And then take a look at this indictment of Chanel Easton. Those are all very interesting documents that we will be getting into when we keep diving into this case. Probably not Sunday, maybe the following. If you guys didn't see my Sunday drive, I personally think that the stippling and the soot thing is a big clue to this. And so what I am going to try to set up this week is an opportunity to fire a 9mm round at individual white targets to see at what distance moving back from those targets do we stop seeing soot while still seeing stippling. That's what I'm going to hopefully do in next week's midweek video. So stick with me. If you haven't subscribed and you want to see more on this case, please subscribe. Please click the like button if you like this content. Hit the notification bell, all the stuff, guys. And once again, thank you so much to my patrons who make it possible for me to look at these documents and bring them to you in these videos. Thank you, thank you, thank you. With that, I will bid you adieu, and I hope to see you next time. Take care. Thank you very much for watching this video. If you liked what you saw, please subscribe to my channel. And if you have any comments or questions, please leave them below.